Hello everyone, good morning or good afternoon, and welcome to this session linking with the merged record. So this session is divided into two parts. We're going to talk a little bit about the merged record. Oh, I'd better switch to the agenda, actually. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit more about the merged record, just to give a bit of background and also some of the plans that we have with the merged record. And then the main part of the session is about full text linking, and that's what Liva is going to do. So she's going to talk you through full text linking, how it works with the merged record. And then we're also going to share a bit about future plans for the linking. Okay, so let me start with the merged record, and this is really just an overview of how this works, what the merged record is, the match and merge process, and what it means to the user. As you know, the CDI indexes content from many different sources, including publishers, content aggregators like ProQuest, Gale, etc., open access websites, institutional repositories, etc. It reprints a lot of different material types, articles and book chapters, but also audiovisual and other material, and increasingly so, actually. In total, we are indexing more than 4 billion records, and that, of course, requires some automated processes for indexing and normalization. That's basically what the merged record is about. The merged record is a deduplication to be able to show one record to users that can be extended and can be enriched over time. It's kind of a super record that provides a view of the best metadata that's available to this user for an item. The input for a logical merged record, this is what we're referring to here, the logical record, are physical records that are also called participants. They can come from many different providers who index the same item. Sometimes it's also from different collections from the same provider, but usually it's from many different providers. The merged record is based on rules and logic, basically. That's why it's called the logical record. All physical participant records are indexed, but the user will only see records that they have rights for. They are either freely available or come from a subscription database the user has access to. That's something that you activated because you subscribe to it. The logical merged record is a result of what we call the match and merge process. That means that we have a series of criteria which govern which physical record can be combined or merged into a logical record and under what conditions. None of the matching rules use just one data point, also because metadata is not always straightforward, as you certainly know, even if it contains identifiers. Actually, like DOIs, DOIs are unique, but they also require fuzzy matching of titles. It's not always possible to just use the DOI. That's just something that we found through analysis. The same applies to PMIDs. Books, dissertations, or governmental documents require also a publication date, as well as fuzzy title match, which is basically stripping out all the extra punctuation and spaces and match against the string. The most common match and merge scenario is with articles from journals, magazines, or newspapers, or conference proceedings where identifiers are used, as well as title, publication year, volume, issue, start page, etc. For dissertations, we are also looking at matching URIs, and the match and merge can also be affected by the language. So again, the process decides which physical record can be merged and under what circumstances. But we also have rules and filters for items not to be merged. So what is not merged? Not merged is mismatched data, of course. It cannot be matched. It also applies to flagged content where the content provider does not want their data to be merged. That doesn't happen very often, but we do have a few, and there may also be others that we are signing up for indexing in CDI that don't want to be merged. So in that case, the content will specifically be flagged as not to merge. It also applies to certain content types, just simply because they are difficult to correctly merge, and that applies to the list you see on the screen, the archival material, images, microform, music recordings, patents, etc. We also have filters for so-called bad titles and title overmatch. That applies to titles that are very short and very common. You have them just many times in the index, and they may or may not refer to the same item. They exist, for example, for then 4,000 times in the index. And in this case, the match and merge cannot be done if there is no real other criteria to identify the record. So in that case, from a certain point onwards, we're just saying we're not merging it because the danger that this is actually not the same record is just too high. One part of the merged record is what is merged and how, and this is what I just talked about. The other part is what is actually displayed to the user. The metadata in the merged record that is displayed to the user is sourced from all available records. Available means here those that are available to this user. That's those that are freely available and those that the library subscribes to. This is a picture also used on our website in the Match and Merge article, and Liva is going to show the links to the support articles later on. It makes it maybe a little bit less abstract and shows what the user sees. There can, of course, be multiple fields of the same time in the different participant records. For example, abstract, every one of them may have an abstract. This may mean that there are several possible values for a field and only one version is chosen for display, and that's based on a predefined hierarchy of record types. In case of things like the subject headings, this is deduplicated list, but from all participant records the user has access to. So for the majority of fields, we only show one value because it doesn't make sense to the user to show all sorts of values. But for things like the subject headings, we show all values that are available here. In the case of content types, we only want to show one content type and use one content type, and it does happen that not all the participants have the same content type, then we usually use those with the most occurrences within the range of the participants. And that's usually a very good way to determine what's the correct content type for something. Of course, there are challenges with that. I'm sure you found already some, you know, issues with that in the index. It's not like this always works perfectly. It's often a balance with everything with data, really, and we don't want to be too strict here to allow the process to match as many items as possible, but we also need to really make sure that it's not too forgiving and the wrong items are matched. So it's always a balance between these things. The matching can be affected by transitive merge problems. It can be affected by granularity. I think one of the issues that we found is that one provider, specifically aggregators, indexes every short article as a separate item, and other providers several as one single record on one page. So that always causes a little bit of a problem here. There's really no way to merge this properly, so we're just trying our best to do this. There can, of course, be metadata errors like typos, and often the data source is not tagging metadata properly, which can also lead to display issues, for example, with dates. One record has the available online date, the other the publication date, but it's not flagged, so it's really difficult to see what is what. That's not something that is static. The entire process, the rules, the enrichment process, etc., are subject to change. Not everything can be resolved, but we can try to make this as accurate as possible with the amount of data that our content team manages here. I want to just briefly mention the doc ID because this leads to some confusion and I had lots of questions about this. So just to clarify this, you can see the doc ID in the URL of the full record, but this is a randomly chosen document ID from one of the participant. This does not reflect the sole metadata source of this item. It also does not reflect the activation source for an article or for any item in the index. I think it would probably have been better if we had a sort of anonymized doc ID, but unfortunately this was not possible. So we had to stick to choosing one randomly. But the metadata you see in the merged record is not necessarily from the data source reflected in the document ID. I just want to emphasize this. Again, it's randomly chosen and does neither reflect your activations in ALMA or in SFX, nor it's the sole metadata source. It's just simply a document ID. Yeah, it's a little bit confusing, and I don't think it's a great solution to do it this way, but that's at the moment what we have. So just some words about enhancements before Liva is going to talk about the linking. it was always the goal to first focus on the rollout and upgrade process with single activation and CDI, but then move on with a focus on data quality. And we have some projects already going on. Nothing is going to happen very quickly, but all of this requires a lot of analysis, and that's time consuming. I'm sure you know this. I mean, you work with data also all the time. So none of this is going to happen overnight. There are a few normalization projects like journal titles, for example. This is already working for many of the titles, but not for everything. That applies to record display and facets. There are just sometimes different versions of the same journal showing in the facet. Or in different records from the same journal, we have different journal differences in the journal title. That doesn't really serve the user. It's just confusing. So we want to normalize this better. We are also working towards having more standardized author names. That specifically is something that will happen definitely over time, because there's no quick way to normalize author names. So there's not going to be one big release and then suddenly the author names change. We are going to trying to improve this over time, depending also on the data source. And we have some plans to work more with ORCIDs and other identifiers to achieve better normalization here. We are also looking at subject headings, and that is really just an analysis project for this year. We are looking, for example, at normalizing duplicates that are different because one is plural, the other one is singular and similar. So for this play, that really doesn't do anything for the user. It's just distracting. And we're trying to apply other rules. And the results could, for example, be that we have a separate subject field for normalized subject. But this is really not a specific plan right now. We're looking at the moment at analysis and what is achievable. And after we know what is achievable, then we can decide what we're actually going to do with those subjects. And we're probably going to do some consultancy with the user group at or with yourselves. And then we also looking at working on improvements to metadata correction processes to make this whole thing more efficient. There will always be a necessity for metadata corrections. That's just the effect in such a big index. You don't get this perfect. So we really need to improve the processes to do those improvements. There are some other things, but many of them depend on how we get the data from the providers, and they require a lot more analysis before we can say or if not, we can move forward. I would, for example, like to normalize dates better. So that the user sees, for example, both the available online and the official publication dates, if that's available. But this really has a lot of dependency before we can actually do this. And as I said, none of this is happening quickly or in one big release. Most of these things happen over time, and we are still in the analysis phase, and we need to determine what is really possible. But I wanted to mention this anyway, and we're also usually asking for input. We're looking at what cases people are opening, what's concerning people, what may work and what does not work, and then accordingly do our analysis projects. So with that, I'm passing this on to Lieve for talking about full text linking in CDI.
Okay, so in CDI, full text linking, we have two types of linking. They also existed in Primo Central, and they're listed here on the slide. So per CDI collection, per collection that exists in CDI and can be activated in Alma, we define two methods. The first method is called the link resolver full text linking, and the second one is called link in record. You can find information about each collection and what kind of linking it uses in your SFX and Alma interface. So if you search for a collection, it will tell you CDI full text linking, and then it will be either link resolver or link in record. Now, for link resolver type of linking, the links are actually created by your link resolver, and they're based on the full text activations that you do in SFX and Alma. The mechanism that is used to make sure that CDI information about the specific record that you want to link for are passed to the link resolver is a mechanism that is called the open URL. It's a URL where all the pieces of information about the record are included, and that allows us to send the information to SFX and Alma. SFX and Alma will then check your activations and provide services and create the link to go to the actual full text of the records. So this is the link resolver type of linking. And the second type of linking is something we call link in record. What we do here when we provide you with full text linking is we actually use a link that's stored in the link that's stored in the CDI record itself. So the provider, when they give us the data, when they give us the feed, include a link, and that is checked and deemed to be a reliable and stable link. So then if that is the case, we use the links in the records to provide a full text linking. So this is what we call link in record. In this category, we also include a very small subset of links, which are a little bit special in that they require some kind of an authentication token or a username or password to be included in the link. And in that case, we use what is called in Primo a link template. In Primo V, it's also a template. So here we actually in the CDI record have the template name, and then Primo will use the URL from the template, which includes your authentication information or your token or your username and password, and uses that in the link. So that's a very small subset of the linking records. Also here, the link resolver is not involved. It's the template name and the Primo V link in the template that will be used. So these are the two types of linking. Now let's look at how you can actually identify what kind of linking is used in CDI. The first and the most simple method for identifying the type of link or linking method in your CDI record is if you go to the full view of your record. In this case, I'm looking at an audio CD. So I look at the full display of the record. If you go to the view online tab, what you will see is only one link, always only one link, and it typically starts with a text string that says something like view item in or view record in, and then the name of the actual collection. So this is the typical, a very typical example of a link in record type of link. Behind this sits a link from the actual provider, and this will be used when the user clicks on the link. So here we're not actually leaving Primo, we're just using the link from the CDI record. So this is a typical example of a link in record type of link. Now let's look in the next slide at an example of what this looks like for the link resolver. So for this particular record, in this case it's a book, you can see in the view online, the view it section, you see two links here. This immediately is an indication that this is a link resolver type of full text link because it's more than one. What you also see here is typically what you see here is the names of the collections as they are configured in ALMA. This is because ALMA or SFX link resolvers are responsible for listing the active collections that you can use for linking here. So it's your link resolver is already in action here, is working here, and is providing the collections that are active in ALMA. So this is a very typical example of a link resolver type of link. And this is the easiest way to identify for a specific record in CDI, whether it's a link in record versus a link resolver type of collection. I wanted to just show you a little bit, something that's a little bit more technical. So what you see here is actually the PNX of a link in record type of link. So because how does the link work? CDI sends a PNX to Primo or Primo V, and Primo and Primo V will display them to the user. Behind the scenes in the PNX, we have a section which is called links. And that section is dedicated to telling Primo or Primo V what kind of linking needs to be provided. So if you look in the link section of the PNX, and in earlier troubleshooting sessions, I talked about how to look at a PNX for a specific Primo record. I'll come back to it later also. But if you look in the PNX, you'll see the link section. And in case of a linking record type of link, you see there an element which is very specific to this. It's called link to resource and it's marked in yellow here. So this is the section in the PNX which contains the link that the provider had in their record and that is going to be used for linking to the full text for this particular CDI record. So what does it look like? You get this link to resource HTML XML tag, and then you have $U which contains the URL and $E which contains the code for the display that So this is an example of a linking record type of PNX. You also see in the delivery section that there is an indication that there is full text. Now, in the next slide, so what we show here is a PNX example of a link resolver type of link. So immediately, if you look in the link section of the PNX, you see there is no link to resource element here. There is no indication, no URL also. So in this case, Primo or Primo V will just use the open URL templates that you see in one of the elements here to then create an open URL with all the metadata from the record that you looked at. You also see that in the delivery, there is an in the delivery section of the PNX, you see there is an indication also that this is full text. It's not full text linked to resource as in the previous example, but it's just as full text. So this is an example of what you will see in the PNX when you are looking at a link resolver type of full text link for a specific record. So this is another way in which you can recognize the two different types of link, whether it's for this particular record you're looking at, whether it's a link resolver versus a linking record type of full text link. In the next slide, I have a small example of a PNX record for a record with no full text. So in this case, you'll also again just see in the links section of the PNX, you'll just see the template references. But in the delivery section of the PNX, in this case, you will not get any full text. The code that you will see in the delivery section says no full text. So here you don't get any full text. Okay, so this is really, if you want to look at something more technical, if you want to really see how does this work in Primo or Primo V, then the PNX link section really gives you the idea of is it an open URL type of link, a link resolver type of link versus a link in record. Now let's look at what we do in Exlibris to determine for each collection whether to use link in record versus link resolver. And for this, I want to first talk a little bit about what are the pros and cons actually of using the two different methods. So let's first look at the pros and cons of link resolver type of linking in CDI. First, let's look at what are the positive things or what is good about linking to the link resolver. And the first thing that we want to mention here is that you have a lot of, if the full text links goes via the link resolver, you have a lot of control as a library. You can configure the links that will appear from the link resolver via the SFX and ALMA link resolver, via SFX and ALMA activations, but also you also have some configuration that really allows you to define the wording for each of the services that will appear in your UResolver menu. Also the order of the services as they will appear. You also have what is called display logic in SFX and ALMA, where you define don't show this service if I have another service. So there's a lot of customizations that you can do in the appearance of the services in case the link, the full text link, is a link resolver. So that's definitely a big plus here. You can also show multiple links. If you have activation from multiple providers, then you can show multiple providers, and that allows the user to choose. And also, in case there could be a potential problem with the link, they can also always use another link. It's a link resolver type of linking works especially well in case there are identifiers in the CDI record. Identifiers such as an ISSN or an ISBN, a DOI, a PubMed ID, a PMID, or provider IDs that can be used as part of the full text linking. It's also important to mention here that linking to via the link resolver means you're not limited to the data provider that is indexed in CDI. So the link resolver allows us to link to collections that are not directly indexed into CDI via provider coverage, but they are we're linking here via alternative coverage. What's less good about the link resolver is that in case of linking via metadata, not via identifiers, there is a potential for metadata mismatches. So we only link to via metadata for those collections where we cannot link via an identifier. But in case we have to, or in case it's a combination between using identifiers like ISSN and metadata such as titles or authors, then we have a greater potential for metadata mismatches and, as a result, linking issues. So that is a disadvantage of the link resolver type of link. Now let's look at the next slide and look at what are the pros and cons of link in record type of linking. So first of all, for linking record, the link comes from the data provider, the provider that gave us the CDI records. So it's a very simple mechanism, and it's a very, in general, very reliable link. So it also works very, this type of linking works very well in case of records that do not contain identifiers that can be used for linking, or where we do not have a reliable link syntax to link to the collection. So in case of records that don't have any ISSNs, ISBNs, or DOIs, this is a very nice and foolproof link. Then we look at some disadvantages of the link in record type of link. First of all, there are no configuration options, and only one link is available, at least at this time, in the CDI record. You, as a library, you don't have control in the sense that you cannot choose what the link is, and you cannot offer multiple links if they are available. One last disadvantage is that linking here is limited to what's available from the data providers. So it's not available for alternative coverage that is not indexed directly in CDI via the data feed that we get from the provider. So these are the pros and the cons of both linking methods. Now let's look at what we do when we get a new ingest a new collection into the CDI index, or when we determine what kind of linking, full text linking, will be used for a specific CDI collection. The full text linking method is defined per collection by the content team of XLibris, and the criteria that we use are that we will choose, in general, we will choose the link resolver type of linking via the OpenURL for any selective and aggregator collections where we have a good linking syntax and where we have good identifiers. This because for these selective and aggregator collections, the chance that you that there are multiple providers and that you want to have this configurability as a customer is very important. So we choose link in record in cases where the record is only available from a single platform, and or the link is difficult or impossible to create using the link resolver. If there are if there is a greater risk of metadata mismatches, or there is no stable link syntax that can be created, then we use the link in the record. Now we have a document about these pros and these pros and cons, or when we decide to go for which type of link, and there's a link at the slide here. We'll be providing the presentation so you can look at it later. Let's go and look now at the merged record. I talked about linking in general in CDI, linking record versus link resolver. Now we have to look at this case of the scenario where it's not just one provider that gives you that gives us in CDI this record, but there is multiple providers. So it's a merged record. It's available from multiple providers. Now, how does the linking work? Now let's look first at the simple case. First case is where all the participant records, all the records that you are entitled to look at according to the rights, according to the activations that you have done in Alma and SFX, are contributing to a merged record, and they all use the same linking methods. In that case, it's a simple scenario. If it's a link resolver type of linking that all of the participants use, then we simply use the link resolver type of linking. The open URL will be sent to SFX and Alma, and the active services will be displayed. So that's simple. If it's a link in record type of method for all of the participants in this particular merged record, then we pick the most reliable link. We have to make a choice. We can only show, at this time, we can only show one link, and we choose the link based on what we have as internally, which is a prioritization of these what we call link rules. And so it's so if just to talk a little bit about the prioritization, primary publish, we look at the reliability of the link here, and we look at, is it a primary publisher versus an aggregator, and this is it an institutional repository, etc. So this is the prioritization. If it's two primary publishers, then at this time we just pick one of the two. They have the same priority weights. So this is case one. This is a simple case where all of the participants have the same method for linking. Now let's look at the more complicated case where we have a merged record, and some of the participants that are in this merged record use linking record, and the others use the link resolver. What we do then is we, first of all, if the record is not open access, and if a link in record type of link exists that the library has access to, then we pick this particular link. So we take the link in record if it's not an open access record, and if there is, the library of course has to have access to this particular link from the provider. If there is, if it's link in record, if there is at least one of the participants that the library has access to is a link in record, but the record is open access, we make sure that we don't prioritize the open access link over the subscribed content. So what we do is we check the link in record. If it's if the record is open access, we check that there is link in record for subscribed content. If not, then we prefer and we will show the link resolver link. So here we make sure that we, for example, would not prioritize link in record types of links from open access collections over an open URL to subscribed content. Right, so this is the current priority rules for the merged record. They've been in place for a number of months now, and we've gotten very good feedback on this. So it looks like we tweaked this priority to what is good for our customers. Again, if there's any issues with the linking priority or you have any questions, then you can contact CDI Info, or you can submit a Salesforce incident if it's a real problem. Okay, so I talked a little bit about the priority of the merged record. The last part of my presentation, and that will be also the next slide, is talking a little bit more about OpenURL linking. I'm not going to go into more detail about linking record type of linking because essentially we just take the link from the record and we show it in the CDI in the CDI full display, and that's all there is to it. But for link resolver type of linking, I want to spend a little bit more time to explain this, because it's more complicated, there's more parties involved, and also we also received more questions about this type of linking. So I want to go into some more details on this. This is getting to be a little bit more technical. So if you are not interested in doing more analysis on links that you have, or if you this is just for your information, it may help you to understand better how the linking via the link resolver works in CDI, and it could help you when you report issues. But this is something that if you don't want to get into the technical details, you can forget about it after this session. So how does link resolver linking work for CDI? There's a little diagram here with different steps, because that's really how the link resolver linking works. It works in steps. So first of all, we have a CDI record, and it's a link resolver type of linking, and that's how you can see that in the link section, which I showed earlier. Now, if it's a link resolver type of link, what's very important is the added data section of the PNX. This is the section that's used to populate the open URL. And what happens is that the pieces of metadata, the title of the article, for example, the ISSN, the volume, the issue, the author, all of this information from the added data section is used to populate a URL, which is called the open URL, which will be sent to the ALMA SFX link resolver. So if you want to look at what kind of information is sent in the open URL, then you need to look at the added data section of the PNX. Once the open URL is filled with all these pieces of metadata, this open URL is then sent to SFX and ALMA. And SFX and ALMA try to match the open URL metadata with the book and journal data that they have in the SFX and ALMA knowledge base. This matching uses identifiers such as ISSN or ISBN. It can also use book title information. And the purpose of this match is to find active portfolios. We also match on coverage information, so we match date, volume, and issue information. And at the end of this matching process, ALMA and SFX know these are what the activations are in your environment, and they will know which services to show in the ALMA SFX services page. In step four, the user sees the different active services in the CDI full display. And then when a link is actually clicked, when a service is actually clicked, SFX and ALMA will be creating the actual full text link by using an ALMA or SFX target parser. So these are the different steps. You see here, there's lots of different components that are working here. You first start from the CDI record with all the metadata. You use a mechanism called the open URL to move this metadata to ALMA and SFX. ALMA and SFX do some matching to find the active portfolios, and then ALMA and SFX will create the actual link. So if you want to, if you have an open URL type of link and it's not working as you expect it to in CDI when you're linking, then looking at the different parts of this flow may help you to understand what is going wrong and may help you to report an issue to support. So the next slides are actually just going briefly through each of the steps. So first of all, if you want to analyze the linking, and in case of open URL linking, first thing you can do is you can look at the PNX of a particular record. So just a brief recap on how you look at the PNX of a particular record. There is a Primo PNX bookmarklet that you can use. And if you use it, you get the PNX identifier showing. When you click on it, you actually see the PNX information. You can alternatively also use a method which is to add the show PNX true string at the end of the browser URL in the full display of a record. Both methods will lead to the same thing, which is to look at the PNX itself. So let's look at the next slide. And here you see the section of the PNX that has the added data section. So the added data section it's also used by CSL and by the citation actions in Primo and Primo V, but it contains really a summary of all the information that is available in the CDI record that's important for the link resolver. So you have typically ISP identifier information, title information, and then coverage information. All of this is used to populate the open URL. Now, when ALMA and SFX get this open URL, they use some matching rules to check for active portfolios. So what are these matching rules? We first of all match by identifiers. We match by ISSN and EISSN, by ISBN and EISBN. And that's our preferred matching. If we cannot match by ISSN because there isn't any, or ISBN, we match by a combination of book title, journal title, so this is the second type of matching. We also use date, volume, and issue information to check for coverage. So this is the added data section. Keep in mind that all of this information from the added data section is included in the open URL. Additionally, we also use a little bit of information from the PNX control section, and that's typically the some identifier information for specific providers. When there's identifiers that are specific to a provider that can be used for linking, they will be included in the control section of the PNX. Right, so now we've looked at the added data section. Let's look in the next slide at the open URLs. How can you identify an open URL that is sent to ALMA or to SFX? Let's first look at ALMA. If you want to know what the open URL is that actually is being sent from CDI to ALMA, and then what you do is you have to use the Chrome browser. You go to the full display of a CDI record and you press F12. That will bring up the developer part of the Chrome browser. It gives you lots of technical information about the requests that are being sent. You then type Control F to refresh the page. And then in the network tab here, you see here network, and it's marked in red. You type open URL in the filter for Primo Alma and PNXS for Primo V. And then you will filter the information, all the information that is being sent to include this, the open URL. Just also make sure that you have all there so you get all of the information that is being sent. This allows you to get the open URL from that ALMA will receive from CDI in your browser. Let's look in the next slide at how to get the open URL sent to SFX. The method is a little bit different. There is actually different methods. First of all, what you can do is in the full display of the record, you can right click on the link. So here I clicked on link to online resource. And if you right click, you get the option to copy the link address. This will give you the open URL. Alternatively, you can also use the option in Primo to open this in a new page, or you can use open link in new window. And then what will happen is you will see in the SFX menu, you either in the top URL location bar, you'll see the open URL, or if you don't have a location bar there, what you can do is you can right click in the SFX menu and click on view source, and you'll see the open URL there in the CTX object section at the top of the HTML source. Okay, so this is how you check the open URL in SFX. Last few slides are about how to go and look at the context object. Okay, there's a slide here that shows you what an open URL looks like, just to give you an idea. So the first part is always the URL of the ALMA SFX link resolver, and then you have all the pieces of information. That's all the metadata that describes the article, book, or document that you came from in CDI, each of them separated with an ampersand. Okay, let's look at the next slide, because that's the next step. Once ALMA and SFX get the open URL, what will happen is all this information, all these pieces of metadata that we looked at, will be stored in what is called a context object. This is really what happens after ALMA and SFX do their matching magic and look at what are the active portfolios. If you want to look at what's in the context object, here are some instructions very briefly on how to look at the ALMA context object. For Primo ALMA customers, what you can do is you can right click in the view it section, and then you select view frame source, and then in the debug section you actually see the full context object. Let's look at in the next slide at how you can do this for Primo V customers. So for Primo V, you right click in the URESOLVER menu and you click on view page source. And then again, you will get a debug section which will have the full ALMA context object. So if you want to see what the information is that ALMA received and what ALMA then used to match against the SFX or ALMA knowledge base, and how to look for active portfolios, then this is what you can use. All right, let's look at the next slide. So this is how you look at the context objects in SFX. You're in the SFX menu, you right click on and select view page source, and that will open the HTML source of the page. At the top, you will have a section called CTX object, and that shows you the context object with all the information that SFX received and then used to do matching in the SFX knowledge base. All right, so this is how to look at the context object in SFX. Let's go to the next slide. What's of course important if you're looking at why links are showing up is you look at the ALMA and SFX knowledge base. So this is an example of where I did an ISBN search in the ALMA interface, and I found an active book with active portfolios for a particular ISBN. So this activation in ALMA is really what drives the link in CDI in this case. The next slide, you'll see the same screenshot, but this in this case from the SFX admin. So in this case, I'm looking at a particular journal, and I can go to the active portfolios for this journal to look at what kind of activations did I do to make sure that this particular journal could be used for linking, for link resolver linking in CDI. All right, this concludes my presentation. I have one more slide, and that is to point you to some documentation and what to do in case of questions or support issues with linking. So that we have two important documents. One is on CDI and linking, and one is on match and merge. Both were used as a basis for this presentation. So if you want to read up on them, if you want to know more, then this is where you can find information. And we also have some information on what to do about in case of linking issues and in case of general questions. Going to give the presentation back to Christine so she can continue.
Yes, thank you, Liebe. So I'm just going to talk very briefly about future plans. I'd already talked about the plans for the merged record, but we also have a few plans about linking that's really based also on your feedback. First of all, we're planning to add all links to every record, and that's the link in record and link resolver. I know that this was something that a lot of people asked for. It's not so simple as it looks, and I cannot tell you at this time what the preference settings are going to look like and how exactly this is going to look like, because this is rather complex. You will probably want to have some control over what you show there, and that's going to be something that we just need to discuss and analyze and see how we're actually going to do this. It may be that we're not able to do a lot of configuration options or provide a lot of configuration options for that with the first release. But we are planning to add all links for every record by the end of the year. All links meaning, of course, only those links that you have access to. We're not going to show any links that you don't have access to. So all really applies here to everything that you have rights for. So this is planned for towards the end of the year, and really the details that's like the UI design, the order, any configuration options is currently not set yet. We still need to go through the analysis to see what we can actually offer here. The second development that we are working on is CDI Quick Links. That's a new feature to provide direct links to PDF and HTML content directly in the result list. You can see here an example here. We have an article here, and you have the PDF link. You click on the PDF link and you get the PDF. That's really to satisfy convenience for users. Users really want to just have full text in one click, and that is going to provide this. We're only ever going to show one PDF and one HTML full text link on the brief result list, not two. Not to confuse people, if you open the full record, then you will get, also, of course, all the links, but on the result page, you will always get one link from the from one provider. Initially, we are working at the moment in getting providers on board. So initially, you will not have so many providers, so you will never have really the kind of conflict that you may have several links. But longer term, obviously, there may be cases where you have access to two PDFs, and for that, we will also provide some configuration options. At this time, we are working on the development. We are going to work with some early access customers later this year from September onwards. We haven't really looked for anyone yet, but we will start soon. And if you're interested in working with us on this and testing it and or help testing it, please do contact us. I'd be happy to work with you. So again, this is something that we're planning for later this year. We're going to start with like 10 to 20 providers, which we are currently contacting, and towards the end of the year, towards November, we are planning for the general release. it's not going to be masses of providers at first. Maybe there are just a few that are relevant for you, but I think it's a very useful feature longer term. So this is the second development that we are currently working on. First of all, the links to every record to every record, we're going to add all the links. That's the first one, and the second one is the CDI quick links feature. Okay, and that brings me to the end of this presentation. Liva showed in an earlier slide the CDI info email. Again, that is an email address that you can use for general questions about this, what you saw this in this presentation, but obviously also everything else in CDI. If you have anything specific, any specific problems to report, you really please use the support system, because we don't have support analysts behind this email address. But for general questions, we are very happy to receive them from you and to answer them. We're also going to use this feedback, or we're already using this feedback, to improve our documentation. So it's very valuable to also hear these questions from you. All right. Thanks everyone for joining us today in this session. We hope that this was useful for you and we answered some of the questions that you may have had. Have a good day.
Thanks.